pleasure of introducing Onofrio Semeraro. Onofrio, he received his PhD from KTH, after which he joined LADX for a postdoctoral position. And after that, since 2014, if I'm not...
17.
He holds a CNRS position at LIMSI, old LIMSI, and what we know now as LISEN. So today he's going to talk about reinforcement learning strategies for control of fluid flows.
Okay, thank you.
Of course, we can...
Not on Zoom. If you want, you can send me the link, and then I can share the screen. Yes. Maybe you can send me the link in Zoom. Yeah, it's Onofrio Sem. I can write it. Gmail.com.
That would be because we have few people. On
yes, a dot.
Yeah,
I don't.
Yes.
With or without computer audio? Maybe. Yes. Works? Okay, so thank you for being here. Thank you for the presentation. So it's a pleasure to talk a little bit about the works that have been carrying on the reinforcement learning in the last years at LISN, formerly IMSI. So before starting, I acknowledge the persons that are collaborating with me in this project. So Alessandro Bucci, which is a former postdoc that have been behind most of the results that I will show here. And then currently Amin, which is here, and then Remy, which instead are carry on the subject and try to figure out what's going on really with those techniques. The seminar is meant at clarifying a little bit the connection between the control theory and the reinforcement learning, so possibly also to demystify a little bit this black box that currently people are using in fluid mechanics, but very often also with the results, which I found personally a little bit naive. And then I will show some results that we obtained in some test cases, like the Kuramoto-Shishke equation, and then more recently in Navier-Stokes equation. I just start with a little introduction on why we apply machine learning technique in fluid mechanics. Currently, people are perhaps abusing a little bit of those techniques, but from our viewpoint, it's quite interesting. In fact, you see how many of the things that we were used to do in fluid mechanics now can be renewed or refreshed a little bit under the lens of what can be done in machine learning. So I take an example from my postdoc, the one in LADX. So imagine that you have a turbine jet at high Reynolds, so with an inlet and the flow motion from left to right. In turbulence, turbulent jet in particular, is associated noise, which according to recent theories can be also obtained by analyzing structure that develops in particular in the vicinity of the inlet, the so-called wave packet. And those wave packets has been analyzing in a variety of techniques. One of those are linear models, for instance, the resolvent analysis, of which here I show the model that you get from this analysis when you consider a stereo that is equal to 0.4, And although this is a linear model, so something which is simplified with respect of the dynamics of the full system, then you see that we have a pretty much nice correspondence with what you can get from the experiments. And when I say what you get from experiments, what I mean is that here what you can apply, for instance, are a classical POD analysis, the proper orthogonal decomposition modes, which in the machine learning domain is known as PCA analysis, so principal component analysis. And probably Staranek can explain to you there are also nice connections between the PCA and then the neural networks. So already here you can see that we have powerful methods within the neural networks family that can in fact mimic what you can get with the simpler methods like the PCA, or even make this a little bit more rich from the dynamics that you can extract. Associated to those modes, one can observe that then there is a time series analysis that can be carried on. So if you take the entire flow and then you project on those modes, in particular if you consider the pressure, then you can see that if you plot what you can analyze in time at different positions along x, what you see is something that is pretty much coherent. And so an hypothesis that one can carry out is that one can deduce the dynamics which is underlying this time series analysis. And what we did at the time was, in particular, by using linear transfer function, that is a more control-oriented approach. But why not? One can also use some nonlinear models, which in the classical sense are very ineffective, because this is something which is even not robust from the analytical, from the algorithmic viewpoint. But once again, and this we see now very often in literature, one can also imagine just to run a neural network, for instance, that is capable of learning at the different position in X what is happening in time and try to reconstruct a model which misinterpretability, of course, but is still able to make prediction of those dynamics. So all this for saying that what is done traditionally with the statistical methods, like also the nonlinear RMAX, can be done now in more structured way with the neural networks or the techniques which are analogous. Second example instead is more into what I will show today, which is control. So of course we have a number of cases in which one may interest in trying to modify the flow around an aerodynamic surface for different conditions, from the separation to the laminar to turbulence transition. And for all those cases, one can identify a cost function from now ahead I will indicate with the J, which once it is identified allow to define a control problem where we can minimize or maximizing quantities like drag, lift, or minimize the noise. How is it going with Zoom? So I disconnect from Zoom. Okay. No, no problem. Okay, so as I said, from those two examples, you can clearly see that many of the applications that we were used to do in the past with other techniques now can be refreshed and reviewed under the machine learning lenses. In particular, in the first case, is what I was referring to, like classifying structures or identify patterns in the flow can be seen under the lens of the unsupervised learning. Once it harnesses inputs, outputs, like in the time series analysis, one can carry on and supervise the learning approach instead. Control problems are strongly related to reinforcement learning. This is really the topic of the discussion today. And more in general, there are many more examples that in the last years are literally booming. I didn't have time to search on Google Scholar the curve, but I'm sure that it's an exponential one. And then for reinforcement learning one in particular, yes, we will see when it saturates. But reinforcement learning is making the same exponential growth, so there are cases that are quite early, like the works from Biferal and his collaborators on navigation problem in turbulence. This is a case in 2D, the so-called Zermelo problem. Kumuzako started already in 2015 with schooling in swimming of fishes, and now I think it's moving also to swarm collective motions of models of fish modeled throats, simplified analytical solution, and also some turbulence modeling. Recently has been analyzed throat reinforcement learning. So since I already mentioned it quite a few times, so let's check what it's about. And I do a warning somehow already now. I will do it from the viewpoint of control. So I will use a nomenclature that is probably not the common nomenclature that is found in reinforcement learning books. But then at the end you will see that in fact one can see control itself like a special case within this framework. So I will apply all this on the Kuramoto-Iwashinsky equation, which is becoming a quite popular system because it's 1D, so it's rather easy to make simulations with that. So 1D, I mean that it is just special extension along X, and then the other quantity in this plot is time. In particular, when the domain length is 22, the regime is chaotic, so you can identify different invariants in this domain. But those are the four invariants that you can identify. When I say invariants, I mean zeros of the equation, so all these equal zero. And what is interesting is that, as I said, it's a chaotic solution.
What do you mean,
zeros? Yeah, so zeroing the x delta t, then I get the non-trivial invariants of the system. So the null solution is the trivial one, and then four solutions. Fixed points, exactly. Exactly. So, in fact, yes, exactly. Those are initializing the fixed point, t equals zero. And then those are all unstable. So after a while, then there is exponential growth of perturbation, and then they start to... in all those cases, I think we initialize with a very small noise. Forget. Because we will use those as a target for our dynamics. So yeah, I introduced those because for us will be the idea is to identify control law which stabilize the system towards those points. Exactly. Exactly. In the Kuramoto-Iwashinsky, so for sure at L equal 22 we have four unstable fixed points, two traveling waves, which I don't show here. And then for shorter domains, then it passes from stable systems to periodic one, to quasi-periodic, to chaotic one. So I'm not sure we have stable points in this domain, but for sure for different domains, yeah, you can get those. And in fact, if you just make it running, then the system is, as I said, chaotic, so it will just erratically go in time and space. And what we plot here is a projection over the three Fourier modes, and then you see in fact that the time signal that you get then it's erratically moving, where all the points E0 to E4 are the points that I was showing before, while E5, E6 are the traveling waves. So the idea would be, for instance, to drive the system from E2 to E3 for stabilizing it. So what traditionally is done, as I was saying in introduction, is to introduce a cost function. So a cost function consists on an object or objective function, as I write in this slide. Well, the idea is to minimize the energy of the system, which is given by the first addend of the integral, without spending too much in energy when it comes to the control, where U is in fact the unknown control signal that we want to identify. So we have this first part that is the part that you want to minimize, and it must be constrained by the dynamic of our system, which in this case is the linearized dynamic. So A is the system matrix, and then B essentially is where we introduce the action into our system. So in general, this is possible only when we have systems which are linear or linearized, so in which the linear dynamics, say, make sense with respect to the full dynamics of the system. And the fixed point I was showing before are typically the fixed points around which you linearize your dynamics for the design of the control. Those Lagrangian approach enables to write three equations, typically, or two equations plus optimal condition. So the equation which is the dynamic equation of the system, the equation associated with a joint, and then the optimal conditions which allow to determine which is the optimal signal that will allow us to minimize the objective function. There are two big categories of methods, the iterative methods that essentially are based on this solution, which is an iterative solution, with techniques that one can set according to the hypothesis that we have. There is also possibility of running in one shot with the algebraic Riccati equation the control. This is something that is possible only when we know the system and when we can do that, because we have also a problem about the size of the system, in particular with the systems which are larger than 10 to 3 number of degree of freedom, then it's starting to be a little bit costly to solve this equation. But the whole idea is that what is classically done in linear control, as I said so far, requires some hypotheses which are quite constraining. So we need a linear dynamics, first of all. As I said, not always the linear dynamics then is relevant for the entire system. Plus, for some cases like this one, then we also need to know, of course, the model. Unless we are able to reduce the model system or to identify it from measurements, then also this can be problematic. So having a representation of the system which faithfully reproduces the dynamics, also if it's in the linear case. For all this reason, one possibility is at the same time to turn towards the nonlinear case, plus introducing a number of hypotheses or techniques which allow us directly from the measurements to recover some of the information that we need for identify these control laws. And this is what is happening when we switch from the linear to the nonlinear optimal control. So in this case, I do a little change. So for now I add, I will not want to minimize anymore a quadratic performance index, but I will just consider so-called reward that in fluid mechanics can be, for instance, a value that is scalar like drag coefficient or maximize the lift coefficient. So here we can have some scalar that are related to the physics of the system. We will have a map which is nonlinear, so I do not necessarily require to be linearized in this case. And the control law is still here called like policy, is called like policy, but is still identified here with U. So we have two functions now, which are nonlinear in the continuous case, the policy, which is related to U, and then the reward, R. So from this formulation, we can do a further trick, which is the following. So in practice, we can break the integral. So rather than considering from t to big T, essentially we identify the instant reward, so the reward time t to delta t, and then we consider the future action from t plus delta t ahead. By then going towards the limit for delta t that goes to zero, then it's possible to get this equation that is rather famous in control. It's called Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman equation. This is in continuous formulation. In the next slide, there is the discrete counterpart. And this formulation, essentially, it's SS solution J. So essentially, we identify this continuous function from which then one can derive also the policy. In fact, it's not the Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman equation. It's simply the Hamilton-Jacobi. Then Bellman entered into the game in the 54, when then working out the so-called dynamic programming, then it was realized that that equation, once that we introduce a discount factor, essentially is the continuous counterpart of what is possible to get in discrete form. Now, this is quite interesting and needs to be explained, because then everything revolves, in fact, around this equation, in which we see that there is the reward at a distant time, and then the value function analyzed for all the states from n plus 1 ahead. In particular, what does it mean? So imagine, and this is the Bellman principle, to have a problem which can be sketched like this. So can be a chess play, for instance. Can be also, imagine an airplane that has to start the mission from airport A and get to the last airport through a number of airports. And then, for instance, those numbers indicate, for instance, how much we need to spend for getting from an airport to another one. Or once again, if you think to the chess play, then of course you have a number of steps that you can do, but then you need also to figure out strategically what can happen later. And not all the things that instantaneously are the most rewarding one, like this step from start to this point where we get 11 as reward, are necessarily the one which get the highest reward. If then you consider that, for instance, after one that is cheaper, then you can get 20. So it's the little idea is that according to the time horizon that you have, if you are able to break your problem in a number of sub-problems, then the question is which is the optimal path that then optimizes the entire one and not just the next step. So this is really the Bellman idea behind this equation. So an optimal policy has this property that one can divide in suboptimal problems the entire problem, and then we can regard the state resulting from the first decision as a sum of number of optimal policies that you can get step by step. For solving this problem traditionally, and if you remember, this is clear from the continuous form where we get a minus here, we solve it backward in time. So you start from a target time, in this case our goal, and then moving backward with complete knowledge of your system, then you can optimize, identify which is the optimal path. And this is quite important because in fact then it's about an offline planning which is solved backward in time. But this is not what physically happens typically, because then if you run it online, for instance, first of all, you have different options and then you don't know where you are ending up. And then also here we are putting ourselves in a quite luxurious hypothesis, so we know the entire system, which typically is not the case. So from the Bellman equation, one can move to another paradigm, which is the reinforcement learning one, and then finally we got at the main subject, in which instead one try to do it forward in time. So we do not go from goal to backward and then we identify the optimal path, but we rather go from the starting point and according to how much we have been exploring iteratively our state action space, then we identify online or eventually also offline, but this will be clearer later, what or which is the optimal path. And in particular, what is important is that another aspect which I didn't stress before but now makes more sense to highlight, here we do not have anymore anything which is related to the model, but we have a reward which, as I said, can be drag coefficient, lift coefficient. We have a value function that at the same time can be a scalar that we can identify from the system. Can be also, imagine this room, the temperature, for instance. So we do not really need to know the entire state. We just need a measurement that can be scalar in time. So this means that we can interact with the system and then observe from the interaction how then is modified the system itself. This it's a little bit cleaner when you think to robotics, for instance. So imagine that you want to train a robot or, for instance, a driverless car. Then after a number of training episodes, the car, for instance, will know when to bend to right or to left after a few tests in which probably it also goes crashing against the wall, for instance. In this case, so it's exactly the same. So we have a number of tests of interaction with the system from which then we observe the system, we learn the system, then we know also how to control it. So this is pretty much the sketch. There are numerous ways to solve this problem, so we'll just provide a couple of hints about the nomenclature. So one first important thing is so-called actor-based reinforcement learning. So just for explaining this sketch, imagine that once again you want from, just a moment, yes, you want to go from point A to the point B, for instance. So one can fix one policy. So we identify U, which is here, and so we try out it, simply. And then associated to this U, which according to this formula is associated also to a reward, we actually have a sum of reward, which can be accumulated towards the trajectory. And then according to the reward that we get, we can find around this trajectory if we have a better policy that allow to maximize or minimize according to what we wish that reward. So in practice, in this case, it's like we try out a number of trajectory for getting in B. And then once that we have been doing this training, then the one that fulfill our rewards, it will be the one that we will consider optimal. This somewhat is related to the so-called the Pondragon maximum principle, which is a condition which is optimal and necessary for the optimality, but is not sufficient. Because if you think about it, essentially we are sticking on a few trajectories, but we are not exploring the entire phase space. So this does not guarantee that we are identifying something which is optimal. This could be something which is working, but is suboptimal. So as we said before, one can break the problem in different steps. So a different perspective is so-called the critic based on the reinforcement learning, which now our function is also a function of U. In this case, what we do, rather than going directly from A to B in our trajectory, is more like attach sub-step. We can try out different paths and then identify the one which are optimal in each sub-step until we get them to B. So this is a different perspective in which then we can guarantee the fact that the Bellman equation is fulfilled, and this will be also a necessary and sufficient condition for the optimality. What is important here is that, of course, this works very well when you have knowledge of your system. Markovianity means essentially this. So in practice, we know the entire system. In the best case, you know already the model, but of course, we start from the condition in which the model needs to be explored. So already from this, you have these two classes of systems that can be of algorithms, the actor and the critic class. You can also merge the two in the so-called actor-critic case. And then according to the way you want to train your system, then you can get further methodologies. So one can do the so-called on-policy seeking of the policy. So a little bit like here. So in fact, we want to get in B. So our behavior policy coincides with the target policy. So essentially, we go in a way that once we train the system, we are training it for reaching this point. But in case instead, this is the case that it is off policy, so we do a training before the control itself, then one can make a distinction in between those two processes, such that we do not just learn how to optimize, but we, for instance, first learn the system. And then once we have a minimal knowledge of the system, then we try also to optimize. In a process, as once again, it's iterative and make of sub-step. This can be also merged with other aspects, which are the so-called exploration-exploitation trade-off analysis. So in fact, if we go directly from A to B, say we do something that is called greedy, we exploit directly our U. So maybe we do not explore much of the system, but we are already satisfied with this policy. In the other case, in particular the one that is related to this off-policy test, then instead we also explore essentially what is happening. So you already see that by using actor or critic on policy of policy, leveraging a little bit between exploration and exploitation, we have already a number of possibilities that if you think then how many flavor reinforcement learning algorithm strategy exist, makes sense of how from just a single equation, which is a Bellman equation, then you have those hundreds of different algorithms that essentially allow us to approximate this. Before going to the fluid mechanics, finally, there are just a few take-home messages that I like to stress. So first of all this has been around at least for 4 or 5 decades. So it's not something which is new. All the names for all this framework are approximate dynamic programming or neurodynamic programming. Then reinforcement learning was the one that was most usually found in literature. Has nothing to do with the neural networks. Or for better say, neural networks is probably the most flexible and advantageous way to approximate value function and policies, but one can use any kind of approximation. You don't need the neural networks. Actually, neural networks with all the parameterization and then the possibilities that you have in the cost function introduce further hypotheses, further parameters that one has to fix apart for all those techniques that, as I showed before, allow you to identify different flavors for the reinforcement learning. What I show then, I started from a linear problem, and then I tacitly at some point start to talk about Markovianity. So I missed an important step, that everything can be rewritten within the Markovian decision process framework. So if you open a book on reinforcement learning, you will find always this framework, of which then the optimal control is a special case, not vice versa. And then, okay, be careful when you find model-free. Sometimes machine learners call model the neural network. So something in reinforcement learning that is model-free, in fact, is with the physical model, but those are details. So if you have a question on this, of course, you are free to answer. Otherwise, now I will show the two examples. One is the one from what I started to discuss, so the Kuramoto Sivashinsky, and then another example of bluff bodies. Yes. Yes, it does. The second example is I can put the question on hold, because the second example we have is pretty much explanatory of this. So I can anticipate that, yes, of course, for cases which are not simply linear case or oscillator case, it matters a lot where you place the sensor, and then one has to have in mind really classical techniques of observability if you want to succeed. So for instance, the second case, we use the Token theorem, but I will go on that.
So you have a very specific camera with optimal goal.
Yeah, true. But yeah, of course, one can consider also different strategies. But what I mean, the things that attracts us a lot of this framework is that it's not just optimal control. So a lot of techniques, like also the model predictive control, adaptive controllers, can all be seen under this lens. So there is an entire taxonomy that one can drive for this very general framework, and then to identify for the single specialized case then where you end up in your technique. So I would be curious to know more about this one. It's the first time that I hear. Probably it can be seen also as a specialized case within this very general framework. As I said, it's because of the Markovian decision process and because of the generalization that you have in the Bellman equation, then many of those cases then end up to be special cases of this framework. Yes. Yep. For instance, in the Lagrangian formula, I guess you need the constraints, so you need to know the model. You learn the mod, so you learn the optimal path without knowing the model. So the model it's learned from the interaction with the system. Of course, as I said, there are then different nuances then according if you do it before offline or you do it online, but the idea is exactly that one. Iteratively, with a number of episodes, you progressively learn to get something which is more and more efficient and then possibly optimal. So for the Kuramoto Sivashinsky, yes. Mm-hmm. So one of the things I didn't say is that the value function is a contracting map if you get a policy which is stabilizing. So essentially you get something which is of the type Vj is bigger than Vj plus 1. So if it's a stabilizing solution, the one that you seek, then you are sure that you are not deviating too far from your target. So if this can answer your question. Then of course you can have failing policies, of course. Then not all the training ends up well. So in fact, most of the things that I will show now are given as also an average over a number of models that have been training. That's another aspect on which then I did not insist too much, but the optimal control is still an advantage to be mathematically well posed, and then you can essentially introduce a number of margin of guarantee for your robustness. Here is not. At least so far, there are scientists that are working on this, but there is no protocol for giving guarantees of the robustness of the performances. So our setup here, it's such that we have sensors, so we just locally sense the system. Your answer will be not answered here because it's way too much at sensor here, but okay. For four actuators, essentially we want to force the system so to identify, once that we introduce a long X, those four actuators, which is the time signal which in fact will be such that we can minimize the state U. So our reward is to minimize it. So we take a proxy for the energy, U square, and then we try to minimize it. Let's try. So in fact, it's really like a loop, which is not far from what you have in control. So we want to identify a policy, as I said, U, which, knowing the sensor measurements which end up here, allow us to introduce inside the actuator a time signal. And for doing that, we need to essentially use the measurements of the system, which are in particular the state or a proxy of the state at time t. We know also u at the time t and the reward which is associated with that. And we want to know at xt plus 1 what is going on. And based on the knowledge of xt plus 1, then we can identify the value function q. So in fact, you see that what we want to minimize in the end is the difference in between the q at the time t, the reward at time t, and what we expect to happen at xt plus 1, knowing what is happening in t. So it's a so-called temporal difference. And then using the gradient of the temporal difference, then we can do the update of the policy. So essentially, as you see, we have two gradients to identify, the minimization of the error on the critic part, and then the improvement of the actor policy. And theta and omega here are the parameters of the neural networks which are inside our critic and actor. So just for being a little bit clean, we introduce the neural networks. In the neural networks, we have a number of weights that needs to be identified. Those weights are trained using backpropagation, or in any case, optimization. This optimization is based on some gradients. That are those gradients which are identified within our framework, in which we learn at the same time the critic part, Q, and the actor policy, U. It's a little bit technical, I know, but just for making a little bit the point, what does it mean training? Essentially, training means that from the measurements, from the interaction, we learn those gradients that allow us then to identify when converge Q and U. And then, okay, many of you will be familiar with this kind of sketch, which are on the right, but when I say we train a neural network, this means to identify both the weights and then other weights like the bias, which are the arguments of the nonlinear functions which are identified within the structure of the neural networks. Okay, all those blah blahs for showing one plot, which is this one. So finally we do what I was suggesting in the beginning. So we can In particular, in this case, we have three different control laws. So one that moves the system from the unstable state E1 to E3, or from E3 to E1, and then from E1 to E2, and then from E2 to E3. And then the way we define it is with a reward, which minimizes the distance in between X at the time T and the target state. The target state being for the three different policies, the three different points E1, E2, E3. We are obliged to introduce a discount factor, which I was mentioning before, and with just 1 hour training or on a normal laptop, then it's possible to get those offline policies, which allow you to drive the dynamics in the unstable environment after learning the system which is underneath. Just two things about those control laws, and then finally the example for wrapping up a little bit of thoughts on the observability problem. So we tried also, for instance, we want to drive the system to E3, let's try different points in the phase space. So before I was saying we trained it from E2 to E3, let's just change the initial condition. The good surprise for us was seeing that, in fact, from any point randomically picked up inside the phase space, we are always able to get to E3. This suggests that, to some extent, our training was robust enough, so in the sense that we were able to explore enough the system, so such that we were not, say, just learning something that from one specific point was able to drive the system to E3, but it's more general than that. So we can say that the Markovianity could be fulfilled. I don't know methods for verifying directly, but this was more an a posteriori verification. One thing that is important, that this goes back to the question, does make sense to use those methods or not? Well, for the Kuramovsky-Vyshinsky, there is a simple solution for controlling it, which is given within the linear control laws. Well, what we found here is extremely complicated. So this is essentially the signal in time. And this is what we read from the sensors. So essentially, with a saturation of Q, we get something which switch on and off continuously. So it's really like the so-called bang-bang control. This is something which physically cannot be interpreted. So it's a control law which is extremely expensive. It's not very significant from the physical viewpoint. One may say that we have found a new non-trivial control law, but in fact we simply were not able to get the optimal solution. So that's is one of the aspects that one has to always have in mind. Because of this enormous number of parameters, then it's a little bit also hard to constrain the solution to be the simplest one or simply the optimal one. So this is a little bit in contrast to what I was showing before. So yeah, we got probably Markovianity, but then very likely it's not the optimal one. Since time is running, then I will show quickly something we have done in collaboration with the P' Institute, in particular with Thibaut Guégan, which was a former student from Laurent Cordier. So we consider the pinball system. It's a bluff body, in which we have three cylinders which are free to move. So you identify essentially a control law that minimize, for instance, the total drag of this system. So our actuators are in fact the cylinders themselves. So according to how you rotate them, then you can control the wake. It's a system that shows quite a rich phase space. So you go from symmetric case to periodic symmetric, asymmetric case until chaos. I will show just results for Reynolds 100, which are the asymmetric cases. And then we test two different setups for the sensors. So a grid which is covering essentially the entire area where we have the bubble behind the three cylinders, and then just three sensors just behind the cylinders themselves. So this one is the reference case, 9 probes. And this is what we get. So if you consider the drag coefficient, the drag coefficient associated to the mean flow is given in red. The one associated to the base flow, which is an unstable state, is slightly lower than is the one in green. And then you can get a reduction from around 4 to 1.5 with those three signals that are the signals that essentially make rotating the cylinder. So in two cases, the one up and down, they counter rotate at the maximum allowed speed, which is 3. And then the middle one, in principle, the optimal solution would be just 0, so just stop. We have some motion here because possibly we needed to be more refined, or probably there was just too much noise inside the exploration part. But then what you get from the physical viewpoint looks pretty much like this. So we go from a case in which you have a bubble which is rather extended, and then because asymmetric is bended in one of the two positions. While instead, when it's controlled, the bubble is shorter, which justified why you reduce the CD. But still, you may have some patterns because, as I said, the middle cylinder was still moving despite the optimal one would be just to get something steady. So this is our reference for what concerns the algorithm that was used here, which is so-called TD3. Now, the question is about observability. So we tried this game. We reduced it to 3 pops, which was the second configuration. And we do not achieve the same performance like before. So we lose from because we go from 1.5 to 2.5. What one can do is to rely on the same very 3 probes and use somehow virtual probes, in sense that by introducing some channels from the tokens theorem, then we were able to recover some of the information. This of course makes sense here because I don't know if how many people are familiar with the tokens theorem here, but essentially it's a method which is purely geometric, which allows from a partial observable number of points inside your compass system to recover a projection of the underneath attractor. So in this case, which is dominated by some frequencies, essentially by unfolding by using the tokens theorem, the dynamic from just one sensor, is possible to have a reconstruction of the underlying attractor. And this is a little bit of what we are relying here. But of course, the point is that this is a dynamic which is relatively simple. So here is possible to do that. We had also guesses where to place the probes. In general, the most complex cases, or just if I think to subcritical case, this is much less obvious. And in fact, you typically see that people tend to abuse a number of sensors, because if you do not have enough sensors, then you lose a lot of observability. And then what we see here is already rather drastic, can be even more drastic, and then you don't learn essentially a policy that allows you to have some control. For curiosity, we have been trying an online policy. This PPO has been used quite a lot by other groups, in particular for the cylinder flows. It works even better to some extent, because here we have something which is a little bit more closer to what would be the optimal law. In fact, the middle cylinder stays practically to 0. But then you also see that being online, it takes a little bit more time in as a number of episodes, so the iteration during which you train your control law, to get something which is converging. Actually, here it even continues. So essentially, here is once again a trade-off in between being very quick in training, a little bit slower, and then online, offline, and so on and so forth. So it's there is no obvious recipe. And this is more or less what I already been saying. So with this, I finished the presentation. For I like to insist a lot on the current challenges. So observability is one as such, clearly. So if you use a lot of sensor, things works. If you try to synthesize the information with a number of localized sensors, then things do not work well, and then there is a lot of limitation that comes also from very classical problems that can be found in control theory, like controllability, observability, and so on and so forth. The more the complexity of the system is high, and here paradoxically the pinball is easier than the Kuramovsky-Vashinsky, the larger the amount of data is required for getting convergence. This is once again something we know from statistical physics. So the intrinsic dimension or correlation dimension then is related also to the number of points that are required in time for getting to convergence. And this is something which holds also in neural networks. Of course, we are interested in doing this as cheap as possible. So there are tons of different flavors that people are starting to try out, like the constrained cost function or hybridizing things with model learning and some a priori knowledge, so with the dual twin duals, for instance, twin digitals, and so on. But as you see, then ultimately the question could be also, we know already a lot about the Navistock system, so you do not want to learn it from scratch. But maybe we can rely on all those techniques for learning what we typically do not model, or we want to improve what is already done within a little part of the phase space in order to expand essentially our control authority, where essentially the nonlinearity does not allow us to play any game. And with this, I finish the presentation.
Thank you, Onofrio. Any questions?
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yes, we did. I didn't show this it here, but yeah, was actually we started from learning the Kuramovsky-Vashinsky, and then we try to learn how to control it. But so it's actually I didn't put those slides because it was a bit lengthy, but I think I have it here. Yes. Yep. So we tried it. So the on the left is the Kuramovsky-Vashinsky equation. Actually, it's even in a larger domain now that I'm seeing it. We use the so-called long short time memory time neural networks, which are neural networks which do not just learn how to go from T to T plus one, but also gets in so-called gates the memory of the previous step. So it's like what is happening in the autoregressive models. So essentially you get also the past history, and then it may, by correlation, essentially you learn what is happening at T plus one with all the points backward in time. And then the error was pretty low, as you can see, so it's possible to do something. This was done at a time in which Edward Ott have been proposing learning for Kuramovsky-Vashinsky with an analogous technique which is called reservoir computing. And our question here, we actually have a paper submitted now with Sergio Chibaro, it's more to understand why then it works so well, because the suspect is that in fact we are learning just these specific trajectories, so-called overfitting problem. So for instance, when learning the models with the neural network, then the question is model general, or we are just learning a few number of trajectories which are the ones that we observe during the training. So this is a big open question on the subject, but yeah.
I would like to mention that here in the audience you have Yves Pomol, who has conjectured that the Kuramovsky-Vashinsky equation had a finite density of degrees of freedom. So you're able to reconstruct the Kuramovsky-Vashinsky equation using the extension of the Jenkins theorem. You could maybe clarify the finite number of degrees of freedom.
That's very interesting. Yeah, that's very interesting. In the end of the day, all those techniques are inverse modeling, so why not? One can try out it. Agree. I agree. That's another line of research, the one on extreme events. Yes. In that case, what one could do is going directly to the MDP, so to the Markovian decision process framework. You can use clusterization, something that Peter does a lot. So essentially, you can identify, say, a discrete counterpart for your phase space with the clusters. And then, for instance, identify which are the populations which are related or representative of the extreme events. So trying to literally cut the links in between the dynamics, which is a dynamics characterized, for instance, by low coefficients of a drag or lift, and avoid to go to the extreme events, for instance. But yeah, it's this is an aspect on which we are working more into the Bayesian statistics rather than frequential statistics, because then you would really need tons of data for getting it. There are no naive questions.
No. No, in fact for us it was more a playground to speak. So at the very beginning, for instance, we were not even sure how long would have been taking a training. So before jumping on DNS, one has to be extremely conscious on what we are doing. Plus is something from which we could start from not full observability, but still putting a number of sensors, which was important. Plus there is a solution, which is the LQR solution, which is optimal. So the question now, which some people in this room will sort out, it's how to constrain or which information we need, or also just symmetries to be exploited for getting the solution that we know to be optimal. Because from one side, one can brag victory and move on, saying that we found a nonlinear way to control it. The truth is that, yes, it works, but it's not satisfactory at all from the physical viewpoint, because it's not the solution that is optimal. So, and the mantra is, if we do not reproduce the linear solution, whatever is done in the nonlinear case probably has a little sense from the physical viewpoint. So one has to be extremely conscious about what we find, and for that we resort to simple systems where we know which are the classical solutions. Yes. So the student has tried also 100 at Reynolds 200, and it was still working good enough. So it was the last Reynolds that he tried. It's a chaotic case, Reynolds 200, as compared to the case that we consider is asymmetric, periodic. But it seems that at least for this kind of bluff bodies, also if it's chaotic, the dynamics still is possible to do something. My point is that probably cases which are dominated by precise frequencies may have less challenges as compared to subcritical cases. So it's more a matter of nature of the flow, and for instance, for boundary layers flows, I don't think those techniques will be necessarily successful, frankly. One can try out, we are playing a little bit on the observability side, but as I said, one has to be very conscious that probably it's more, it's wiser to rely on the a priori knowledge rather than doing it from scratch and then challenge yourself with the limitation that you already know within those systems.
So also had one question, maybe a comment. Yes. So one question I had is that, I mean, it's very interesting, but if I were to compare this, for example, to you mentioned Bayesian or stochastic-based optimization derivative-free methods, would it be comparable, or would I be better off to do just a derivative-free optimization in the cost that I pay?
So
because you mentioned 1 hour training for the Kuramoto-Shimanski equation, right? So I'm assuming that it would be less if I were to.
Yeah. So in the end, there is no panacea. So I think it's a lot case dependent. So already with the pinball, for me it's a little bit too difficult even to assess which is the good strategy here. Because this one is closer to the optimal one, takes more time, and it's a simple case.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's a complex case, probably will never converge.
Mm-hmm.
Also because it's attracted to what is a limit cycle. So essentially the phase space is also very simple. So an online training essentially will be always be attracted there. While here is certainly faster and probably something which works better on a more complicated phase space. So my answer is it depends case by case. What I like of the framework is that also gradient-free methods or stochastic methods can be seen under the lens of the Markovian decision process. So those are gradient-based. You can have Monte Carlo-based one which are without gradients. So
you basically change the
this one in particular can be also done as a Monte Carlo searching. You don't need the TD here.
So that actually goes to the sort of more of a comment thing.
Mm-hmm.
Is So the network, the learning that you do, am I allowed to say it's unsupervised because it goes input output for you, the sensors and actuators?
It's right? Supervised.
You don't supervised, but you don't actually use the information that you have from the operators of your equation, right? So you in the cost functional that you set up, it's only the data. It's only the x minus x output or desired that you want.
It's a matter of viewpoints, but
so what if you were to, because it's, I think it's a shame we know what the operators are and we know what is the equation underlying.
Of course, in the cost function, you can add pieces. Yeah.
Do
yeah.
you think that would have merit to basically add operators to the add the underlying equation and just penalize your solution for the underlying equation?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, but it's just one of the possible techniques. So, from my viewpoint. So the neural networks is the way you approximate the value function of the policies. So it's already one step ahead with respect to the entire formalism. So one can read of the neural networks and then use other techniques which are more parsimonious.
Yeah.
And then within there you can add constraints which can be physical or not. Can be also compressed sensing techniques, just for saying. One can also modify simply the framework. So you can put yourself in an innovation form and then you learn essentially what changes or what you don't know. So I agree with you that there is merit in working out with the neural networks. So for instance, here we use the LSTMs, which already have a lot of information inside. But yeah, you can do a lot of more things. What is needed to be avoided to me is to over-engineering it. In sense that it's a little bit risky to add just a number of complex strategies when, in fact, if you look more to the physics and what you know from standard techniques, things could be a lot easier than what they look. So, for instance, a recent paper for the ceiling the flows, they were using swarm methodologies optimization, like the one in on ERAP. Paris Benedina, it's a good paper, but it's not a critic, but you don't need optimizing a posteriori where you need to put a sensor. You have a lot of strategies that comes from heuristic based on global modes and balance modes and so on and so forth. So I completely agree there is a merit introduced in physics, but it's not necessary in the cost function. That's my message. Yes. Yes. So the we are still working on that. So probably you remember we discussed it with the Colin Leclerc at Onera. It seems also the same team by belonging to Denis. They had probably the cavity flow. So I don't know if they sorted out, but. Yeah, there is a number of problems there that still make difficult to identify the control law. From my viewpoint, it's still the time delays in between the sensor actuators. Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So this goes with the observability comment. So with the pinball, the physics is that one. And then in the specific case we showed here is a limit cycle. Then you get the toroid and then the chaos that comes from there. But with the cavity, yes, we have the multimodal behavior, which makes things much less obvious. But no, we resorted to simplify model to understand it. So no solution yet. Unless you put a number of sensors on the cavity flow, and then this will work. But and people publish with 50 sensors, but this is not the ending game. Merci.
For the meeting, we will restart at 6 p.m.
Thank you.